sustain the wings. Sustain the Wings, presented by the Army Air Forces Training Command. Each week, this program features the band from the Army Air Forces School at Yale University, Captain Glenn Miller, Corporal Ray McKinley, Johnny the Kid Next Door, and many of your old friends. And now, Captain Glenn Miller.
Thank you, Lieutenant Don Briggs, and good evening, everybody. Tonight's program salutes the Army Air Force's Air Service Command at Patterson Field, Dayton, Ohio. Major General Walter H. Frank, Commanding General. Well, now the boys in the band are ready and waiting, so first off, it must be jelly, because jam don't shake like that. A newcomer to our program, a lad with a swell voice, we think. Private First Class Johnny Desmond sings the currently popular How Sweet You Are.
How sweet you are. How sweet you are. How dear your tenderly smile. How sweet to know my heart can glow from just the warmth of our first embrace. The world's a lovely world by far. When I
our footsteps echo back from the walls of this giant warehouse as we walk down its main corridor together, Johnny and I. You know Johnny?
Yeah, I thought so.
Sure, he's the kid who used to live next door to you. The kid who used to deliver your groceries from the corner store and made you wait while he stopped to play marbles with the other kids. Yeah, well, today he's not stopping for marbles or anything else. He's delivering far more important things than groceries. He's one of a huge organization of men and women, soldiers and civilians, known as the Air Service Command of the Army Air Forces. A soldier in coveralls whose job it is to supply America's planes with everything they need to keep flying and to keep fighting. This vast warehouse we're walking through is Johnny's workshop here at Patterson Field, Dayton, Ohio, headquarters of the Air Service Command. Stretching off on every side of us as we walk along are rows upon rows of shelves jam-packed clear to the high roof with rivets, engine parts, instruments, maintenance equipment of every description for servicing and repairing all the 143 types of aircraft made in this country. Let's stop here a minute at this shelf on the left. Hand me that box, Johnny. Yeah, thanks. Here's a cotter key, no more than an inch in length. And now come on over here. Yeah, come right along. Yeah, right here. Take a look at these. Bit bigger, aren't they? Yes, sir. Brake assemblies for America's giant B-24s, so big they need a 2-foot shelf for each one. Yes, there's everything here. And that's only a sample of all the different parts handled by the Air Service Command. Over 400,000 pieces of equipment. 10 times the number of items you'll find in the largest mail order catalog. Now, where do you suppose all this material comes from? Well, Johnny can tell you. It comes from everywhere. It's the product of American ingenuity and toil. It comes from the busy assembly lines of our great war factories with their whirring motors and pounding machines by the thousands. Yes. And it comes, too, from the little shops in every corner of the land where a handful of workers bend over one or two machines. From the little garage on the outskirts of town, now converted into a miniature factory, where Dad works the lathe, Mom sorts rivets, Sis keeps the books, and Bud handles the metal press after he gets home from high school each day. Yes, from everywhere they come. Thousands of plane parts. A mighty river of material flowing into this mighty warehouse of Johnny's to be distributed by the Air Service Command to its network of depots and sub-depots all over the world as replacement parts for America's fighters and bombers. Their destination? Anywhere and everywhere. Wherever Uncle Sam's planes sweep the skies. Over the frozen islands of the Aleutians, an American bomber comes limping home to its base, its motors coughing like a wounded sea lion. Over the green hills of central Italy, 4 German fighters tear the tail assembly of a P-47 to shreds. Over an American base in New Guinea, Jap bombers blast a hangar, ripping the wing from a flying fortress. From every battlefront, calls for help come back to Johnny and his fellow workers in the Air Service Command.
Plane grounded. Must have spare parts immediately. Send at once. Urgent.
Instantly, the tremendous organization of the Air Service Command moves into action. There's not a second to be wasted. At top speed, the needed supplies are collected at the warehouse where trucks are waiting to take them on their way. Faster, driver, faster. Somewhere, the air crew of a bomber's waiting for those parts, counting the minutes until they arrive. No time to stop for a cup of coffee this trip. Keep them rolling, mister. The train's waiting for you at the station. Pour on the steam, engineer. Pour it on. You're routed straight through. War Department orders. Yes, and there's a ship waiting for you at the dock, waiting for that precious freight that you got on board. Hurry it up, Captain. More speed. Over on the other shore of that ocean, there's a transport plane waiting for you. Its engines idling, ready to carry to their destination those big boxes marked Rush. Air Service Command. Full speed ahead, Captain. At a foreign port, the equipment is quickly unloaded with an air service officer supervising the job. Then it's rushed to an airfield where it's loaded on the transport plane, and an hour or so later at a bomber base, it's being fitted onto the wounded bomber by the ground crew and Air Service Command technicians. Tomorrow or the next day, those parts that we saw in Johnny's warehouse may be flying in a bomber over enemy territory, dealing destructions to Nazis or Japs, and helping to win the war of the air, thanks to the Air Service Command. Back in the warehouse, Johnny works on, delivering the goods, and proud of the fact that he is a vital cog in the biggest supply and maintenance organization in the world. That's a big organization. It has to be. For the Air Service Command furnishes supplies for all Army Air Force planes everywhere. It repairs, overhauls, and rebuilds these same planes here and overseas. It trains the personnel needed for its specialized supply and maintenance jobs. It prepares American and Lend-Lease planes for shipment overseas. And it operates the new 39th Air Freight Wing, which handles all Air Service Command freight, as well as air shipments for all agencies of the War Department within the continent, carrying millions of pounds of air freight monthly. No obstacles too great for the Air Service Command to overcome. No job is too big for Johnny. Whether it's warm jackets for our airmen in the Arctic, propellers for a grounded plane in Burma, jungle kits for a bomber squadron in the South Pacific, Johnny will get them there. Yes, sir. Keeping always in mind the slogan of the Air Service Command, the right part, in the right place, at the right time.
And now, here at the tail end, Charlie's to play Hallelujah. Thank you. Medley time. Serenade for the mothers, wives, and sweethearts of the officers and enlisted men at Air Service Command Headquarters in Dayton, Ohio. Here's something old, something new, something barred, and something blue. The old song, Chrysler's Old Refrain. Something new, Private First Class Johnny Desmond sings Blue Rain.
Blue rain falling down on my window pane. But when you return, there'll be a rainbow after the blue, blue rain. And there's a blue star looking down, asking where you are. But when you return, there'll be a sunbeam hiding the blue, blue star. Skies will be much brighter than they were before. When you and love come strolling through the door, then there'll be no more blue rain, just the sound of my heart's refrain, singing like a million little bluebirds after the blue.
The song we borrow is one of Jerome Kern's best from the hit show Roberta. Smoke gets in your eyes. Thank you. Last in our medley, Something Blue, Blue Again.
Are you a young man of 17? And this message is for you. Today it's possible for young men of 17 to volunteer in the Army Air Force's enlisted reserve. Fellas, listen to this. By enrolling now, you...
Hey, Joe, did you hear that?
Yeah. Say, I didn't know a fellow like you or me, only 17, could get in the Air Forces.
Well, sure, I read about it just the other day. You just enlist in the Army Air Force's enlisted reserve, and if they accept you, you get to wear a Silver Wings insignia on your lapel. And after you're 18, you're called for regular cadet training as a pilot, navigator, or bombardier.
Boy, that's something. Just what I've always wanted to do, get in the Air Force. I'm going to ask my folks about it tonight.
Yeah, me too. Hey, turn that radio up a little, will you?
So remember, the Army Air Force's enlisted reserve gives you a chance to do your share in winning the war. It gives you training for a future in aviation, training you might otherwise not be able to afford. So if you're not employed in war production, visit any post office, aviation cadet board, or Army recruiting office, and find out how you can enroll now in the Army Air Force's enlisted reserve. Do it today.
Tomorrow, October 17th, is the second anniversary of the activation of the Air Service Command as a separate command of the Army Air Forces. So today, we of the Army Air Forces Training Command salute this important division of the service, and we extend our congratulations to its commanding general, Major General Walter H. Frang. For 300,000 civilian employees of the Air Service Command and for its tens of thousands of officers and enlisted men delivering supplies for P-40s in China, repairing fortresses in England, servicing our Army Air Force planes everywhere in the world, we play the Air Corps song.
To the hosts of those who love the vastness of the sky. To a friend we will send a message of his brother men who fly. We drink to those who gave their all of old, and down we roar score the rainbow's pot of gold. Here's a toast to the host Of men we boast the Army Air Corps.
Off we go into the wide blue yonder, climbing high into the sun. Here they come, zooming to meet our thunder. Atta boys, give her the gun, give her the gun! Down we dive, spotting a flame from under. Off with one hell of a roar. We live in fame, or we're down in flame. Hey, nothing can stop the Army Air Corps.
I Sustain the Wings has presented the band from the Army Air Force's Technical School at Yale University, Captain Glenn Miller, Corporal Ray McKinley, Johnny the Kid Next Door, and many of your old friends. Next week, you'll learn more about Johnny at the Army Air Force's Training School at Chanute Field, Illinois. Be with us again next Saturday, same time, same station. This program is written and produced entirely by soldiers of the Army Air Forces and came to you from New York City. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
I Sustain the Wings. I Sustain the Wings. The Army Air Forces presents the Band of the Training Command under the direction of Captain Glenn Miller. And now, Captain Glenn Miller.
Thank you, Lieutenant Briggs. Good evening, everybody. Speaking for Corporal Brad Crawford, Sergeants Ray McKinley, John Desmond, the crew chiefs, and the whole gang, welcome to another program of I Sustain the Wings. First off, the big guns in the brass section bust out in a GI serenade to an old Army tradition, Snafu Jump.
Beautiful new melody with a fancy set of lyrics is the contribution of Sergeant Johnny Desmond, the crew chief, to the romance department tonight, Moon Dreams.
You look at that pile of junk. Perfume, silk stockings, shawls, jewelry. Boy, you must have been a sucker for every merchant in Cairo.
Sucker, you're a maiden aunt. This stuff's hard to get back in the States.
Hey, you've got enough of it to open a store. I suppose it's all for your wife.
And what if it is?
Oh, nothing, except you're going to have to get rid of a lot of it.
Says who?
Says the CO. They're sending our plane home for a bond tour, and we're flying her there as soon as she's fixed up.
Yeah, Holly was right. We were flying our own plane back to the States. The Air Forces felt we needed a rest, and it was okay with me. Well, we loaded up, and we took off for home, the good old USA. When we landed, another crew took over the ship, and Holly and I reported to a liaison officer at the nearest port of debarkation.
Sergeants Hollis and Carson reporting to liaison officer.
At ease. Welcome home, gentlemen.
You can say that again, sir.
I know how you feel. You have your records?
Yes, sir.
I'll take these and forward them to the AAF redistribution station at Atlantic City. Oh, before you report there, you both have a 21-day furlough.
21 days. 21 wonderful days at home with Babe. That was too good to be true. I nearly went nuts the next 24 hours, questioning by intelligence, arranging transportation, that kind of stuff. But they got it over with as soon as they could. And before I knew it, I was on a train heading home. My wife met me at the station. And the way Babe greeted me, well, that's kind of our own business. 21 days went by so fast, it seemed like next day Holly and I were on our way to Atlantic City. We were both pretty down because our furloughs were over. But we figured we couldn't complain. We'd had our fun and we were in the Army. We got to Atlantic City and they met us at the station with a bus and drove us to a fancy hotel on the boardwalk. We piled out and walked into the lobby. There was a dance going on and the music was playing. Yeah.
Hey, they must have brought us to the wrong place.
Yeah, this place is too rich for my blood.
Hey, you're telling me. I stayed here once in the good old days. $20 a day it cost me.
$20?
Yeah.
Let's get out of here before they charge us $5 for just standing here.
Shaq, this ain't the right place.
And it ain't the Army.
Yeah, but it was the right place, and it was the Army. No, it was really something. Comfortable? And how? Real beds, not GI bunks in the room Joe and I had. It was just like when I paid $20 for one just like it. Ocean view, swell furniture, everything, just like a regular hotel.
So you know something, Holly?
Huh?
I could stand this for the duration.
This is for me. Did you hear what the guy said downstairs?
No.
No roll call till 1:00? Yeah, that means we can sleep till noon. We don't have to make our own beds. The maids will do it for us.
Yeah, this joint's lousy. No breakfast in bed.
You would, you lug. If it was raining $5 bills, you'd want a raincoat before you... Hey, Joe.
Hmm?
Get a load of this.
What's that?
It's a pamphlet. The flight sergeant gave it to me.
How do you like that? They even give us books.
Hey, Joe, listen to this. Welcome to Atlantic City and the Army Air Force's redistribution station. This is to tell you briefly of the purposes of the redistribution center. Headquarters of the center's here in Atlantic City.
And it ain't bad.
It's a working part of the air staff who was set up by General Arnold so that all Air Force's men coming back from overseas would have certain things accomplished for them.
Yeah, and they're sure doing plenty for us, Holly.
We know that you've undergone tremendous nervous and physical fatigue, that you're tired and in need of rest.
You can say that again, brother.
Two, it's very important that you men be properly placed in domestic commands. The experience that you've had overseas must be passed on to men now undergoing training in this country. The benefit of your experience overseas will be very valuable to them.
Yeah, we could really tell them a thing or two.
I'll say. It's likewise very important that you receive every possible attention. Many of you have been under great strain, and we want to be assured that you're in excellent physical condition. The government owes that to each of you, and it's our responsibility to see that it's fulfilled. Signed, Colonel A.W. Snyder, Commanding Officer.
They sure took that responsibility seriously. They did everything for us. They even arranged for us married men to have our wives down there with us. And you can bet I didn't lose any time in sending for Babe. She got down there in the double, and we had a swell time. You might call it a second honeymoon. Of course, during the day, we had appointments for physical and medical examination, reclassification test, just to make sure we'd be put in the right spot when we returned to duty. But most of the time, we were on our own. And there was plenty to do. Parties, free movies, concerts given by Broadway stars, and the best dance bands in the country. We had golf, skeet shooting, horseback riding, and a million other things we've been dreaming about overseas. And the chow, well, maybe I shouldn't mention the chow, but I put on 35 pounds. All in all, it was a real vacation. And it was plenty easy to take after 17 months of combat flying. Well, the honeymoon was over when I was placed on shipping alert. I sent Babe home so she wouldn't be stuck down there alone and was feeling pretty lonely when Holly busted into
the
room.
Joe, I got my assignment. I'm going back with the skipper.
Lieutenant Stokely on the level?
On the level. He's organizing a combat crew for duty in the South Pacific in about 3 months. And he asked for me to be on his crew. He told me I could stick around in this country as an instructor if I wanted to.
Who wants to? Boy, would I like to fly with a lieutenant again.
Well, you can if you want to. He asked for you, too.
He did? No fooling?
No fooling.
Boy, that was something. A chance to be with a lieutenant and Holly and the old crew again. And the lieutenant asking for me. There's no pilot I'd rather fly with. He's the world's best. But, well, I'd sort of been looking forward to an instructor's job in this country where I could have Babe with me and maybe I could get a family started. Of course, it's up to me to make up my own mind. I don't have to return to combat duty, not for some months at any rate, unless I say it's okay. Boy, I'd sure like to take a crack at the Japs, though, before this thing's over. It'd be kind of hard to leave Babe again so soon after... Well, so soon after just getting to know her real well. What am I going to do? Babe will be waiting when I come home.
This one coming up is bad medicine for the master race, according to all the reports that we've been hearing lately. Volga Boatmen. Thank you. medley time, and that means old, new, barred, and blue tunes played for servicemen's ladies, be they Mom, Sis, or Mrs. Tooby. The old tune, Jeanie with the Light Brown Hair. Sergeant Desmond, the crew chief, sing the new tune.
I couldn't sleep a wink last night because we had that silly fight.
I thought my heart would break the whole night through. I knew that you'd be sorry, and I'm sorry too.
I didn't have my favorite dream, the one in which I hold you tight.
I had to call you up this morning to see if everything was still all right.
Yes, I had to call you up this morning.
I couldn't sleep a wink last night.
A little lend-lease from the Navy now as we borrow Chief Petty Officer Artie Shaw's Begin the Beguine.
Thank you.
Past the Blue Tune, Blue Rain.
One of the biggest opportunities open to women who join the Women's Army Corps is the chance to get valuable training. Training that'll be useful to you in the years after the war. Why, right now, the Air Forces alone are thousands of AWACS learning new skills or improving abilities they already possess. Their jobs are important, war-winning jobs, interesting, specialized work that's vital to victory. In joining the Women's Army Corps, you may choose any branch of the service, air, ground, or service forces. So if you're not in essential war work, visit the nearest WAC recruiting station and volunteer as an air WAC to help keep them flying.
March. What do you do when your pack has got your back as stiff as starch?
This is a mechanized war, they say. That saying is sure a bust.
'Cause all that you see in the infantry is one another's dust. What do you do in the infantry? You hike, you hike, you hike. What do you do in the infantry? You left and right oblique.
Everyone else can ride a jeep or fly up in the sky.
But there's nothing to ride in the infantry. You're just a tired guy.
The hard way. The hard way, sweat till you get there, the hard way.
What do they say in the infantry? They squawk and squawk and squawk. All about miles and miles and miles that they have had to walk.
They march across the ocean, and that's quite a trick to do.
But don't forget the Air Corps has done some marching too. What do you do in the ground crew? You're always fixing planes. Never a chance to sleep and dream of beautiful G.I. Janes.
You're patching a hole in the fuselage or loading the bomber sticks.
What do you do in the ground crew? You fix and fix and fix. What do you do in the air crew when the flak begins to scream? How can you duck when the bombardier's so steady on the beam?
How can you dig a foxhole or jump behind a tree?
Wouldn't you love to march away just like the infantry?
The soft way. The soft way. Try to crash land, brother. The soft way.
What do you do when your gas is gone and you're flying a thunderbolt? You hit the silk and say a prayer and land with an awful jolt.
You drop in a jungle and wrench your back. You're thinking of giving up.
Yet what do you mumble crawling back? It's hop, two, three, four. Hop, two, three, four. Hop.
is Captain Miller saying so long for the band of the training command. Corporal Brad Crawford, Sergeant Mel Powell, Ray McKinley, Johnny Desmond, the crew chiefs, and Lieutenant Don Briggs. Hope to see you again next Saturday, same time, same station. In the meantime, don't forget those lads that are slugging it out overseas. They go for those V-mail letters. Don't let them down.
I Sustain the Wings is a presentation of the Army Air Force's Training Command. Came to you from New York City.
This is the National Broadcasting Company.